The next adjustment that needs to be made is the unearned revenue adjustment. Now, not every company would necessarily have to do this adjustment, only those companies that have unearned revenue. And we've talked about unearned revenue before, and if you think back, remember, this is a situation whenever a customer pays us in advance. Remember, we're not allowed to recognize revenue until we've earned it. So if someone pays us in advance, we haven't earned it. We might have to provide them with a product or a service, but whatever it is that we have to do, until we've done that, we haven't earned the money. So initially, it's going to be recorded as unearned revenue. But when we get to the end of an accounting period, if any of that revenue has been earned, then we're allowed to recognize it. So if you take a look at this example, it says this company was paid $5,000. And this is an advance payment for 10 days worth of services. And they received this money on December 1st. It says the money was recorded as unearned revenue, and that is the proper treatment of that payment. Now it's December 31st. So the question is, how much of this money have we earned? Maybe we've earned all of it, maybe none of it, we don't know. So this is saying that as of December 31st, 5 days of those services have already been performed. So 5 out of the 10 days. So that means we've actually earned half of that money. So I can take that $5,000, cut that in half, and I will recognize $2,500 of that revenue. And I do that by debiting unearned revenue and crediting revenue. So the unearned revenue becomes actual revenue. So that's the way that works. And think about it like this. This is a liability. You know, when they booked this originally, they credited. So now that I'm reducing that liability, I'm debiting. And eventually, I will do all the necessary work, and once I've done that, I will eventually recognize all this revenue. So that is a classic example of the unearned revenue adjustment. The next adjustment has to do with salaries. Now, this is a challenging adjustment to make because all companies have different policies in regard to how the employees are paid. And the problem that happens is the paydays do not necessarily align with the calendar. And when that happens, it does create a little bit of a discrepancy. And we have to account for that by performing a salaries accrual. And in this type of situation, not only do we have to accrue the salary, but then later on we have to do a subsequent journal entry when the actual money is paid. So to see this in an example, we have an employee, and we're going to say that this employee is paid every other Friday for a 2-week, 10-day work period. And the total salary for this employee is $1,000. Now, the last time that this employee received a paycheck was on Friday, December the 26th. It says then the employee worked on Monday the 29th, Tuesday the 30th, and Wednesday the 31st. They will not receive another paycheck until Friday, January the 9th. So you see the problem. They worked for 3 days in the month of December, but they will not receive that money until the next accounting period, which will be over in the month of January. So whenever your paydays do not align with your accounting period, that creates a little bit of a discrepancy, and it's a discrepancy that we will have to resolve. So we do know that in total, that the total salary is $1,000 for 10 days worth of work. So that works out to about $100 a day. So when you look at these two journal entries, these are probably two of the most complex entries that we've ever seen up until this point. The first entry, this one would be posted on December 31st. This is the journal entry to accrue the pay. Now, it's $1,000 that they receive for a 10-day, two-week period. So that works out to $100 a day. And they did tell us that they worked for 3 days, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, the last 3 days of the month. So that's $300. I have to accrue that $300 worth of pay. So I do that by debiting salaries expense and crediting salaries payable. So when I credit salaries payable, that creates a liability. In fact, that is a new liability that we've never talked about before. But just like accounts payable and note payable, again, salaries payable is a liability. Then, later on in the next accounting period, on Friday, January the 9th, which is actually the next payday, then I have to do another journal entry, which is even more complex. In fact, this is a compound journal entry with more than two lines. On this journal entry, I'm going to debit salaries expense for $700, debit salaries payable for $300, and credit cash for the entire $1,000. Now, I think it's helpful to look at these two journal entries side by side. Even though this one is in the December accounting period and this one does not occur until the January period, when you see them side by side, it more clearly illustrates what you're doing here. Ultimately, the way this works is, yes, I'm paying for this on January the 9th. So that's when I want to see that cash come out at $1,000. But of that $1,000, $300 of that should actually be an expense back in December, because that is when they worked those 3 days. And really, only $700 should be an expense in January because they only worked 7 days. So even though the money isn't paid until now, part of it was an expense in the previous month, part of it is an expense in the new month. And then the way that's facilitated is the salaries payable. Notice that the salaries payable has been resolved. We started out with a credit, and then we turned right around and debited. So that cancels each other out. So ultimately, what we're saying is they worked 3 days in December, they worked 7 days in January, but we didn't pay for it until January the 9th. So that's what we can do with these accruals, and we have to do these things whenever our paydays don't quite line up with our calendar accounting period. So that's always a complex adjustment. Of course, one way of avoiding all this is businesses do have the option of simply paying the employees on the middle day of the month and the last day of the month. And a lot of businesses do that. So that way it's a very clean break from one accounting period to the next, and that way they don't actually have to worry about doing these accruals. Now, once we have completed all the adjustments, then we're going to have a trial balance once again, but this is a new version. This is the adjusted trial balance. And basically the trial balance as it was originally presented would be presented again, and it would now reflect a new total balance that shows the effect of all the adjusting entries. But the purpose of it is still the same as it was before. It's designed as part of that system of checks and balances to make sure that we do have equal debits and equal credits.